Have you ever wondered why the cables in a solar system are so dang thick? Or why they're not made out of something cheaper like steel or spaghetti, you know, instead of copper? Sometimes they're made out of aluminum. Today, we're gonna break down why cables are sized the way they are and why they have the materials that they're made out of and what can go horribly wrong if you decide to cut some corners. Stick with me. This could save you a lot of time and money and a headache and potentially even keep your house from burning down. But before we dive in, I am not an electrician, but that's exactly why I'm making this series. I've had to learn all of this the hard way, and I want to break it down so it actually makes sense. And I want to make sure that we're getting solid information, so I'm pulling almost all of this information from Victron Energy's Wiring Unlimited documents. It's a great online resource, and if you're lucky, you can get a hard copy. When electricity flows through a wire, it meets resistance. Think of it like water flowing through a pipe. The smaller the pipe, the harder it is for the water to get through it. Well, the same goes for electricity. Small wires, more resistance, more voltage drop. Some materials naturally let electricity flow better than others. Copper's a favorite because it's got low resistance, meaning electricity flows easily. Aluminum, also good, just not quite as good. So aluminum wires have to be thicker than copper to carry the same amount of current. Here's a fun fact. Silver is actually an even better conductor than copper. It has less resistance and better performance. But unless you've got a vault full of cash, copper is a bit more of an affordable choice. Now that's the conductor part that carries electricity. But what about the stuff wrapped around it? This is the insulator, and it's just as important. Insulators are materials like plastic, rubber, ceramic, glass, etc. They have a super high resistance, so electricity doesn't flow through them. And that keeps you from getting shocked and stops your wires from shorting out whenever they touch each other going through the walls. And a good rule of thumb is that the higher the voltage, the thicker the insulation needs to be. That's why, for example, the PV wires from your solar panels look way thicker than the same gauge, let's say THHN wire. And even though the copper inside is the same thickness, the PV wire has beefier insulation, and that's because it's made to handle high voltages and harsh outdoor conditions. Now let's talk about what happens when you get too small on your wiring. Number one, small wires with too much current going through them get hot. That resistance we talked about earlier, it turns out to be heat. Too much heat, and suddenly you're at risk of melting the insulation or even catching your house on fire. The second big issue is voltage drop. The longer the wire and the smaller it is, the more voltage you lose before it ever reaches your device. So let me give you a real life example. I was trying to run my Starlink Mini, and you might have seen this video, off of a 12 volt battery or a power bank. And I used the adapter, this little janky thing. Everything looked like it would work just fine, but the resistance from the adapter and the length of the wire made it too long, and it dropped the voltage under load below 12 volts and made it so that the Starlink Mini would not actually boot up. Sometimes it really is the wire's fault. So let me give you another example on the other side. When I was putting in my home, my meter is about 300 feet beyond that. So in order to bring the power all the way to the house, I had to run some massive wires. I had to run 4 gauge, which is about as big around as my thumb. And I did go with aluminum, which meant I have to step it up even larger, but the price difference made it so that running that much copper would have been a crazy amount of money. So I opted for the aluminum. I just had to bump it up to a huge, huge wire size. If I'd gone with a smaller wire, I'd have had dimming lights, overworked equipment, and probably a lot of frustration and maybe even damaged appliances. When you're reading through the manuals on your batteries or inverters, the equipment behind us, and it says to use these really big wires, you kind of need to. They've already done the hard math and they're saying, here's what this thing pulls. Don't go smaller than this or you'll have problems. So make sure you always read the manuals and follow the manufacturer's guidelines for the minimum wire requirements. And you can't just substitute aluminum for copper. So just recapping, wire size matters, material matters, insulation matters, and cutting corners on any of these can wreck your system. I know wires are expensive, but this is a place where you don't want to skimp out. I thought about getting into the math and showing you the nitty-gritty of how to actually calculate the voltage drop and all of that stuff, but we might save that for another video. But really, there are so many helpful tools online that allow you to calculate these. It's just not worth trying to memorize. Just do a quick Google search for voltage drop calculation, wire size calculations, or something along those lines. If you found this video helpful, make sure you check out the next video where we're going to talk about connection resistance and why even a perfectly sized conductor or wire can still cause problems if the connection point is weak or corroded. And if you missed the last video on power and Ohm's law, you can watch them here and get all caught up. This whole series is step by step, so stick with me and we'll make sense of this together. I'm Eric with East Texas Homestead, encouraging you to live faithfully and prepare thoroughly for good times or bad. I'll see you on the next one.